All right, good morning once again. Our title for this morning is What the World Needs Now, and our text comes to us from Matthew 22, verses 34 through 40, which read as follows. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law? And he said to him, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all of the law and the prophets. So far, our text for this morning. Now, who got sermon notes this morning? Okay, take those sermon notes and throw them away. So, if you couldn't tell this morning from the title, I had a song in mind when I was writing this sermon. Can anybody think of that song? What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little love. Thank you. All right. Now, I like Mr. Bachrach. Really, I do. There is a little better witness to the Lord's word than Bert Bachrach, and it comes right from our reading today, okay? When we talk about love, sometimes people get a little confused. What do I mean by love? When I say, when God tells us that we should love him with all our heart and soul and mind, and we should love our neighbors as ourselves, what does he mean by love? And when he talks about love, he's talking about that kind of sacrificing, self-deprecating love that puts other people first. When I'm talking to people about getting married and we're talking about love, what I tell them is that love is hard work. It's not easy. It's doing things that go against our very nature, putting other people first, putting someone else before ourselves. But that's the kind of love that we're going to talk about today. Now, in our reading, in our text for today, the Pharisees are after Jesus again. They've heard that he silenced the Sadducees. So he shut down one group of people who opposed him. They're not going to let that happen to him. So they come up with another question to try to stump him. And they ask him, what's the greatest of the commandments? Now, they ask him that because they are all about the law. They want to know which one of the laws is the greatest. Could it be one of the Ten Commandments, or could it be one of the 612 other laws that they've made up themselves and expect people to follow? So which one is the greatest? And Jesus replies, what? Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul in all your mind. This is the greatest commandment, and the second one is just like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All right, well, let's think about that for a minute, because love's a really popular topic. We like to talk about it a lot. So, love the Lord with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. What does that look like? How do we do that? Oh, no, that's a question. I'm looking for answers on this one. What does that look like? How do we do that? Okay, we do it through service. Good. How else do we do that? Prayer. Very good. Where do we learn about God and his love? How do we learn more about him? Right, his word, right? That's where all of that comes from. In fact, Jesus says that those two commandments are so important that the rest of Scripture hangs on those two commandments. In other words, if you get those two things wrong, you get the rest of Scripture wrong. Makes them pretty important. It puts them in a pretty special place, okay? So we learn about God from his word, and in his word, we hear about how much he loves us, okay? And nowhere more so do we see that love than right here at the cross. That is the ultimate symbol of God's love for us. The idea that he loved us so much that even though we couldn't keep his law, even though we couldn't do the things that he wanted us to do, he still sent his son to die for us, to forgive us, to grant us life with him, to take away all of those things that we had done wrong, to remove them from us as far as east is from west. Because he loved us that much, he loves you that much. If you had been the only person that Christ needed to die for, he still would have done it because he loves you that much. Now, oddly enough, we're decorated for the Reformation today, which works out kind of well because over here, we see Luther's rose, which really became a symbol for the Reformation. Now, you've got the heart that represents God's love, but what's in the center of that? The cross, right? Because the cross is at the center of everything that we do as Christians. That is our central focus. And what surrounds that, what radiates out from that, is the heart. It's God's love. So, if we learn about God from his word, and by learning his word, we love him with all our heart and soul and mind, then how do we love our neighbors as ourselves? Okay. Louder.
I said, put them first, but also love them as you do God.
Okay, put them first and love them as you do God. Now, if you're putting them first and you're teaching them about love, what do we want to teach them? Okay, we want to, oh, Erica, I love you. I really do. No, because you're coming up with all the right answers today, and it makes my sermon so much easier. Exactly. If you want to teach them about love and you want to show them love, you show them God. You teach them about him and his love and the love that he has for them, the same love that he has for you. Now, part of that you do by serving them, exactly what you talked about, by putting other people first. When you see people in need, you help. That's part of what we do because that's what God calls on us to do. But part of the way that we show other people that we love them is teaching them God's word. Now, here's the question. If we're teaching someone about God and we're teaching them about his love, and we know that something that they're doing is wrong, that it goes against God's word, what do? How do we handle that? Is it loving to tell someone that they're wrong? I see that shaking head over here. Good, absolutely. But the problem that we run into in our world today is that the world would say no. Absolutely not. In fact, if you tell someone that what they're doing is wrong, that's unloving. You're mean. You're cruel. You're heartless because you would tell someone that they're wrong. You would call someone out like that. How dare you do something like that? That's what tolerance is all about. That's the religion that our world preaches today. Tolerance. If I love someone, then I have to accept what they're doing. I can't tell them that they're wrong. If I tell them they're wrong, that's being intolerant. And then shame on me. How dare I do that? How dare I not do that? How dare I see my brother or sister in Christ that I love, that I care for, that I want to see grow and prosper? How dare I not tell them? That's wrong. You running contrary to God's word. You're doing something that God calls sin. Again, we've had this conversation before. Am I judging them? No. But what I am telling them is, God says in his word that that's not okay. I love you, and I love God, and I know that you love God. And so you would want to know that what you're doing, he calls wrong. And because I love you that much, and I care for your salvation that much, I don't have a choice but to tell you. As Christians, it is our job to share God's love with other people, and we are to do that anywhere and everywhere that we possibly can. We need that reminder that God's love involves the cross, because we can't do it perfectly. We can't. I screw it up every day. If I ever wanted to try to claim that I didn't, just kick me or something. Because I screw it up every day. But every day, I know that that love and that forgiveness is there. Proclaim the risen Lord. That's our job as Christians. That is how we love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind. That is how we love our neighbors as ourselves. We come to them again and again with God's word. We come to them and tell them how much God loves you. You want to know about God's love? You start with his word. From his word comes his spirit. His spirit is given to you in baptism, where he first dwells in you, where he first shows you how much he loves you by forgiving your sins and giving you eternal life. Then he brings it to you again and again and again in his supper. When he feeds you with his body and his blood, he shows you how much he loves you. In prayer, he tells you how much he loves you, and you get to tell him back, I love you too, but guess what? I screwed it up today. Can you help me out tomorrow? What are the keys? Why are these things here? Oh, what's that? Okay, that's confession and absolution, isn't it? Those are the keys right there. The keys to bind or the keys to loose. Confession and absolution. I come to God again. I say, I love you, Lord. Please forgive me. And he says, I love you. I already forgave you. In my Son, Jesus Christ, you are forgiven, renewed, restored. Go already and tell somebody how much I love them, just the way that I love you. So, oh, it's not that bad. I'm almost done. So what our friend Mr. Bacharach says is what the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of, and he is absolutely right. Think about for a second what our world would look like with more love. Think about what our world would look like if every day we set out intentionally, purposefully, to share God's love with as many people as we could, no matter where we were, no matter what we were doing. What would that look like? You know, I think about this week. I mean, it was a tough week. I had a lot of chances to share God's love. I got to meet a brand new baby this week, not even a day old. I also got to do a funeral this week. got to help plan a wedding this week. I got lots of chances to share God's love, and that's a wonderful thing. And then I sit down at my computer, and there's a shooting here and a shooting there. And there are all of these events that make people question God's love, that make people wonder, is there really a loving God out there? There are always going to be more people that need God's love than you or I can reach. Does that mean that we stop trying? No, absolutely not. It means that we do everything in our power to share his love each and every day. Things that seem little, that seem random, can mean so much to someone who's in need of that love. Never, never stop taking those chances. Never stop taking those opportunities to share his love whenever, wherever you can. Amen. Now that peace of God that passes all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. Please rise and join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.